Welcome to Entreprogrammers Podcast, the podcast for developerpreneurs, the podcast where you get to be a fly on the wall listening to real conversations of three developers trying to tackle the challenges they face as entrepreneurs.
I'm not used to clicking all the buttons. Oh, there we go. We're live.
Oh, we're live without John. We got it working.
Caught us by surprise.
Yeah. Yes. They're shooting at his house. I mean, videos. They're shooting videos at his house.
That's my son. I go, psh, 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 psh.
Yep. So 10 minutes before this call, I get a phone call. And it's from the club president of my Toastmasters chapter. And I'm the VP of PR, which makes me the webmaster, among other things.
Oh, no.
The website's been having issues for a while, but I've been so buried with work that I just haven't been able to prioritize it. And so I'm finally getting around to doing that because, yay, I have other people to do all the stuff that I had to do. So she calls up, and she is just she's terrified of WordPress.
Terrified of WordPress.
And she basically tells me, well, we need a system that people who aren't technical like you can use. And I'm like, there are thousands and thousands of people who are not technical like me that use WordPress for their website. And she's like, really? She's like, I just can't figure it out. And I'm like, okay, well, I will set it up and then I will spend 10 minutes with you and you'll know how to use it.
Well, it's hard to imagine a less technical way to create and run a website.
Yeah. Well, she's like, well, can you just look at the GoDaddy website builder? I said, I'm not using that.
Nope.
But it's easy. Will you look at it? Okay, I will look at it, but I'm not using it.
Yeah.
She's like, well, it's probably easy until you have to change something about the website, and then I bet you have a million pages you have to update.
Yeah. Well, there's that, and then the other thing is that, like the elementary school that my kids go to, their website was on Google Site Builder, and it kind of went wild. Like if you're building like a 3-page site, fine.
Yeah.
But you know where they had probably hundreds of pages that they had to manage, it turned into a major mess. So. Mm-hmm. And she's like, well, we're only little lone peak Toastmasters. And I'm like, yeah, but what I want to do is I want to take pictures during the meetings and then post them to the website and let people know what was talked about and things like that to get people interested in coming. And I want to post, you know, an article every month or so that has, you know, something that we learned or discussed in the club meeting. And, you know, anyway. So I'm like, so it's going to get big fast. The other thing is that with WordPress, I'm like, you can get plugins that allow you to integrate it with everything else like Facebook or Twitter or whatever. Yeah. Anyway. So, yeah. And then she's like, she's still asking me and I'm just like, I just wanted to stop and say, you realize we're both volunteers, right? Like neither of us are getting paid to do this. So, anyway. And then, yes.
Nonprofits are so much fun.
Yeah. Yes. And then
you're a nonprofit. You see that means you don't charge us for your time and effort.
That's right. So, you see my mess behind me? It's been this way for it'll shift every week, but I've been.
As the pile slowly tips over and spills on the floor.
That's right. So, I sold my desk. I had somebody try and run a scam through me.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, so I listed the desk on a couple of classified sites and on Facebook. And I had somebody contact me and they said, hey, I'm taking over for John talking about pointless stuff.
somebody has to.
I'd like to buy your desk. And I listed it for like $100.
Yeah.
You know, I'd like to buy your desk because it was the big cubicle thing. And I think you could have seen it in past videos, sort of. So anyway, I just wanted a little more room in here and I wanted, you know, sit stand desks. So I finally sprang for them. So anyway, So they're like, well, we'll send you a cashier's check and then we'll have some movers come out and get it. And you can just, you know, pay them the difference on the check. And I was thinking, okay, well, you know, yeah, you know, put an extra 50 or 100 bucks on there and then, you know, I'll give them the money. Well, I got a check for $2,450. And they're like, yeah, can you just, you know, just, it's a cashier's check. So it, you know, it's probably not going to bounce on my account, but they're like, yeah, just give them the rest. And I'm just like, I don't know about giving somebody $2,000 in cash.
No, there's all kinds of shady going on there.
Yeah. So I texted him back and I said, I'm just going to mail this check back and sell it to someone else.
The Unsure Money Launderers podcast.
Exactly.
Yeah. So then they texted me again yesterday and they said, hey, did you get the excess money out of the account? And I said, and I texted them back and I said, I already told you I'm mailing you the check back. And then I got another text this morning and they're only asking about the excess money. They're not asking about the desk. They're not asking about. I'm just like, no.
Wow.
So, yeah. Yeah, money launderers are us. I'm just like, am I paying for somebody to be a pack mule or for you? I don't know.
Something you don't want to be involved in.
Nice. Yes. So I'm kind of tempted to call my brother-in-law because he's a police officer here in Lehigh and say, what do you think?
Yeah, you know, I probably would have done that by now.
It's probably a well-known scam.
Yeah.
Yeah. He
probably knows what it is. I'd be curious.
Yeah, but the thing is that, you know, the point it progressed to, I don't know if they've done anything wrong. So, as far as anything illegal, let me put it that way.
Right.
So I don't know if there's anything that they're really going to do. Yeah. But anyway, so yeah, that's been interesting. I do have one thing though that I got a little bit overambitious with my people working for me.
Okay.
we'll just put it that way. So I said, okay, well, now I have people working for me that, you know, do all these things like help manage podcast episodes and help manage conferences. So I went in and I basically made a list of all the stuff that I want to happen over the course of putting together a podcast episode or putting together a conference. And in the conference department, I completely and totally and utterly oversubscribe my person that's working on conferences. Of course, she's only working like 10 to 15 hours a week. So she didn't have a lot of bandwidth anyway, but I was like, look, I want to invite speakers every week for the next like 4 weeks. And she's like, I don't have time for that. And then because basically I've decided that I need to start organizing conferences 6 months before the conference, you know. And starting organizing is inviting people to submit proposals and get the website up so they can do that. So, yeah. Anyway, she's like, I don't have time for that. And my guy in the Philippines, his mother went into the hospital. She had a stroke. So, you know, I can't have the overflow go to him either. So I'm trying to figure that out. And then it feels like I'm just piling more and more and more stuff on Shandy, and she doesn't have a ton of time to do everything that I've asked her to do either. So
she's the new person.
Yeah. Shandy's new 20, 30 hours a week, you know, semi full time.
Okay. Wait, so you said, I thought you said 10 hours a week.
No, that's Grace. She's working on the conferences.
Oh, I gotcha. Okay. Okay.
Yeah. I got two of them.
Yeah. So, interesting. What's the bottle? So, is there a way with Grace? Is there a way that you could buy more of her time? Like, is it like just family stuff? Is she only wants to work 10 hours a week, or is there some other commitment?
She's a dance instructor. Okay. And she's usually out a good chunk of Friday and a good chunk of Monday. So that's the limitation. It's her time. It's not.
Okay. So she has another job and this is just fill in the gaps type of thing. Yeah.
And I could replace her, but then I'd have to train somebody new on that too.
Right. So is this a one-time bottleneck where once you get through it, it'll even out?
Somewhat, yes. So the way that I've been doing the invitations to speak at the conference is I have her email all of the past guests from all the shows.
Okay.
And I can probably automate some of that so that, you know, she can just basically, instead of emailing them, she can just add them to a workflow and just make it happen.
Yeah, you should be able to automate that really easily.
But yeah, the other part of that is that, in fact, in ActiveCampaign right now, they're all in a list. So she just emails the list. But the other part of it is I have her go and look on the internet for other potential speakers.
Mm-hmm.
And I like her to, you know, reach out to another 50 or so people. And that's worked out really nicely for me to get great speakers at JS Remote Conf and Freelance Remote Conf.
All right. Well, here's where your VA self-replicates. So have her, like, work with her to hire some Fivrr people to do
the research
at least. So
yeah, I've thought about doing that on Upwork.
Yeah. Upwork would be fine too. But either way, like, if you do, the thing about Fivrr is it's nice because you can do like these really fast turnaround jobs, and you can hire 10 or 20 people to do the same thing.
Right.
And like within, you know, 3 days, you figure out which two of them are competent.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can give them more work. So is there a lot of like just digging around general web research?
Yeah. And for the most part, you know, there are like three or four general areas that you look in. You look at other conferences, you look at other podcasts, you know, and then you just do some web search. You can also look in some of the newsletters for the blogs, but I mean, that's about it.
Okay.
You know, you do some general web research for, you know, I give her a list of keywords. So
yeah. Okay. So, I mean, you could do a video and like where you walk through an example of it, right? Mm-hmm. And then you should be able to give that to anybody on Fivrr and give them the topic area. I've done this before and it's worked out fairly well. I mean, it's probably not going to be as good as you doing it.
Well, no, but that's fine.
Yeah. But usually like what I found is that there's judgment calls and, you know, as an experienced developer, you're going to know how to follow certain threads a little bit better than somebody who's not, but they can get, it's an 80-20 thing. They could definitely get you 80% of the way there.
Well, the other thing is that the judgment calls usually come in weeding people out. There are a few judgment calls as far as like, you know, digging a little deeper and finding somebody, you know, somebody else to invite. But for the most part, the judgment calls are weeding people out. And if they submit a proposal, I can just say, no. You know, because I'm the one that's picking the talks. So,
right. So
that makes sense. I think I could do that. And I think that was the main bottleneck there, was just doing that research. So once they have her a list of names and email addresses, she can just feed them into the system.
What's her hourly?
$12.50.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, cause this, you could probably get somebody for like $3 an hour to do this. This is not highly skilled.
No, it's not.
Labor.
It's web search, and I can tell them a lot of the directions to go in.
Honestly, there are people that specialize in doing this, and they have a bunch of tools that you might not have that make it easier and faster for them.
Right.
Like scraping tools, and they've got different search tools and stuff. So you actually might get a better quality of work out of these people.
The other thing that occurs to me is that the job that I hired Grace to do was essentially this job. Like when I initially hired 20 people on Upwork, so I could probably just find another one of them and just say, hey, do you want to do this?
There you go.
Because I've already vetted people there.
There you go. Yep.
So I, you know, there were three or four people that did a pretty decent job, so I could just go back to them.
Yeah. Yeah. If you get people that do a decent job, you know, that meet a certain threshold, keep them in your like Rolodex.
Yeah. Yeah, that makes sense. I really like that. And the other thing is then it doesn't cost me a lot to have somebody figure out how to do the job for me.
Yeah.
Because you can just manage that and, you know, push it along. So.
Yep. Yeah. So she becomes, you know, you get more leverage out of her because mm-hmm. she's managing people that cost $8 an hour.
Yep. Makes sense. I got one other thing that I wanted to bring up really quickly, and then I'll let Derek or Josh talk. But so I'm going to this retreat because I've been paying Jamie Masters to be part of her mastermind group, and to, you know, I've been getting some coaching. I usually just text her, and then she texts me back. We send a lot of voice messages to each other. But anyway,
I like how you play us off of each other. Yeah. Two mastermind groups. Well, we need to have like a cage match.
I know, right?
I'm betting on us because we've got John and, you know, and yeah. I think Derek could probably lay the smack down pretty good.
I'll sit on someone, man.
Yeah.
I know how to take a punch too. So. Yeah.
But anyway, so one of the things that comes with it is a retreat in Austin. It's going to be in April. It's the week before MicroConf. And anyway, she's basically, one of the things she does is brings in an expert to help you execute while you're there in whatever area you want. And I feel like things are just so up in the air because I'm still getting things settled with Shandy and I'm still getting things settled with Grace and I've got a couple of tools that I'm still in the process of transitioning to and, you know, just figuring out some of these processes and stuff. And so I'm not sure what to ask for. Like how do you identify the big area that's going to have the big payoff for you in your business?
Oh man, you know, this is tough because we kind of went through this, John and I, recently with the roundtable meeting that we went to, because we're at a place in our business where things are growing kind of linearly, and we have all these tasks that we're like, okay, if we did this, we know that we would add $5,000 a month to our revenue. Like that would be like a 10%5 or 10 or 20% revenue bump. And if we did this, it would be another, 10%. And so we were kind of struggling with what to bring up and what to ask for help with in our hot seat at the meeting. And it turned out that what we ended up talking about was the just kind of like our uncertainty about John's future. You know, does he want to continue doing this? Does he want to go and try to do something more mainstream? So like our identity crisis discussion, which ended up being exactly what we needed. And so it sounds like you have to, but you, this sounds like you have to identify a specific set of tasks or like some project that you want to do. Like you're going to actually do some project while you're there.
Yeah. So for example, some of the other folks are doing like their marketing funnel. And so she's bringing in an expert on building marketing funnels. And
oh, so she'll bring in people that will help you with what your specific area is.
Yeah. And her podcast is Eventual Millionaire. Mm-hmm. And so she brings in millionaires who have built millionaire businesses doing this kind of thing. So you kind of get the top notch people to do this.
I don't really have a very good answer. Like I can't say you should work on this project, but you might want to spend some time, like go to a coffee shop with a notepad and spend some time thinking about like, if I were to, like, what would my business look like if it was 10 times bigger? Or,
you know,
like things that are not just like you, not just going to, give you marginal bumps. Actually, so we have a consultation with Perry Marshall scheduled for Wednesday, like a one-on-one as part of our roundtable membership. And he'd mentioned at the close of the meeting, like he was giving everyone kind of a,
we have slices of your pizza
for lunch. Sure. We've got a guest on the podcast here.
That's right. Can I have some of the pizza you bought last night for lunch? Yeah, go for it.
So at the close of our roundtable meeting, Perry was going around like kind of giving everybody like a final bit of advice, and he like looked at me and John. He's like, "I could 10x your business in my sleep." So, because it's like a personality, it's a personality business. It's very similar to what he's done. He's helped a lot of people. Mm-hmm. So basically, for our consultation, we're like, yeah. So about that 10x thing that you mentioned, we'd like mm-hmm. to hear more. So
we'd like you to sleep.
It's going to be very open ended. I have no idea, you know, where we're going to go with it, and what we're going to come right. away from it, but. I think that would be the most productive way for you to think about this would be like, cause you've got all these projects, you know, that if you do, mm-hmm. if you continue to execute them, you're going to grow. Right.
Yes.
So it's not so much how do I grow, but it's like,
how do I explosively grow
this while only working 20 hours a week?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Something like that is going to make you think about it in a different way mm-hmm. than just like, you know, like yeah. launching a book will bring in, you know, we can pretty easily figure out what that would bring in for you. You know, it'll be probably tens of thousands of dollars or possibly six figures. But, you know, there might be something else that shakes out that you're like, you know what, if I did this, you know, that would really blow the doors off.
So. Yeah, the thing is that, and I think this is clarifying some things for me. Yeah, I have to know. I have to let her know now so she can arrange for whoever's going to come. And I mean, honestly, if I'm thinking about my business as it is right now, and I don't think things are going to change that materially here in the next 2 months. The things that would impact my business the most basically are. Now, how do I vastly grow my podcast audience?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so that what that boils down to is, you know, social media and, you know, probably other things that I'm not even thinking of.
Right.
And then the other thing that comes to mind is how do I convert podcast listeners into buying customers?
Mm-hmm.
And if I could get an answer to one of those two things, and I know those are still kind of high level for what she's looking for, then I could probably, you know, because honestly, between all the shows, I probably have, let's be a little conservative and say 35,000 listeners across all the shows.
Mm-hmm.
So if that's the case, then yeah, if I can start converting those people, the customers, you know, have them buying stuff from me, then... I mean that's a big chunk of change coming my way, and I still get to help people with those products,
right?
You know, or if I can, you know, just really grow the podcast audiences, that makes it easier to get sponsors, and the sponsors wind up paying more, and that frees things up and puts me in a position to do more of the other things that I want to do anyway,
right?
So mm-hmm. yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think I agree, like, kind of what John was saying the other week about really like doubling down on the podcasting. I mean, cause you've got the machinery all there uh-huh. and
you can, a crazy idea too.
You can scale it. Right.
Uh-huh.
So, I mean, it could be adding more podcasts. It could just be finding better ways to promote yeah. the podcast and get more people listening or whatever. But
yeah, that's true. So I've actually been talking to some people about starting a DevOps podcast and a WordPress podcast.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Ooh, yeah.
And then I've also.
Do you have a PHP podcast?
I don't. I also have a couple people that are talking about reviving the web security podcast. And they're super excited about it, which usually makes a big difference there. And then I've also, yeah. So John, what John said last week has kind of been stuck in my head all week, and I realized that I've heard a lot of people complaining about 5.js and Ruby 5 going away.
Okay.
Which are two podcasts, they're news podcasts. They just kind of
yeah, 5 minutes of JS.
Yeah.
Mm.
And so I've thought about just, you know, essentially throwing in a third episode of JavaScript Jabber every week. Right. It's the 5 minutes of JavaScript or the, you know, the 5 minute Ruby news podcast, which is Ruby 5. I actually emailed Code School a while back and was like, you know, can I take these over or, you know, buy them from you? And I never heard anything. So I think I may just start my own. It'd be nice to be able to pull those feeds over to DevChat, but if I can't, I can't. So, but yeah, I've been thinking a lot about that. And I think that's a big way to impact my business, but you know, it increases the listenership, but what it doesn't do is it still doesn't get people converting into conference attendees or, you know,
right. But at this
book
point,
buyers or things like that,
at this point, most of your income
is sponsorship anyway.
So, So, I mean, it would be interesting to chart your audience growth as best you can. See like what you're looking, because we've hit the point now with YouTube where we're starting to see a hockey stick.
Oh yeah,
and that's really exciting. That's, you know, that like when you get it to that point and it's like growing under its own momentum, that's really exciting. And there might be a way for you to do that. You also, another thing I was thinking about too would be, you've got all this, could you record your podcasts with video and stick them up on YouTube?
About that.
And then you'd have the transcripts, right? So you have all this really search friendly stuff. Mm-hmm. You could have, because we just started a second podcast, so we're doing daily podcasts now,
right?
And they're just John's YouTube videos, edited a little bit differently. And then we've got, we just started a video podcast because why not? We've got the videos. We just edit the videos a little differently and stick them. So we have two feeds in iTunes now. And we can get twice as much sponsorship money for that. So if you had a YouTube channel or several YouTube channels that were growing like crazy, then you could also charge, you could potentially, you know, double up your, you could offer those as sponsor opportunities too. And YouTube, like for a 30-second mention, we're charging like $300, I think, right now. Uh-huh. So, you know, and we've got potentially like 20 to 30 videos a week we could sell.
Yeah, the video aspect is also, I think it's an avenue for growth. And if I kind of get lukewarm response from my co-hosts
about doing the video.
Mm-hmm. But I think if I came in and just said, hey, look, I'd really like to have the podcast growing. I think video would help. And if you don't want your video on, then just turn it off.
Yeah.
And that way we can kind of opt in. And then as time goes on and things get a little more comfortable around video, then, you know, maybe we have most or all of the co-hosts with the video on.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a lot of those folks wouldn't care. I think they'd be fine either way. And then the one or two that do care, it'd be like, okay, well, if you don't feel like you want to be on camera, then turn the camera off.
Yeah. But yeah, that would be another thing another question to throw into the pot would be like, how can I take exactly what I'm doing now and get a lot more mileage out of it?
Yeah, absolutely. And I actually talked to somebody at CES about like live video streaming, but it would also, you know, it would stream it onto Facebook and YouTube and stuff, and you know, and then it would be captured there as well. And so, yeah, then people could just go watch it live or watch it after the fact, like they do with this show.
Yep.
You know, and then we could have it edited down and all that stuff as well. You know, so it gets cleaned up. But yeah,
YouTube is great because it's like Facebook. I'd be less excited about because that's like something else you have to grow. YouTube is something that will just grow on its own. Like it's a search engine. It's basically a video blog.
Yeah.
And you get all YouTube traffic benefits.
Yeah, I know a lot of people who are doing pretty well with video on Facebook. But yeah, I would just be posting them. You know, I'd be streaming it to and posting it to the page on Facebook for the show. And then if people are interested in watching it live, then fine. And then if not, then they can watch it later. The thing I like about the Facebook videos too is once they're up, then as people watch them later on and react, so, you know, whether they're posting a comment or, you know, you can actually hit the little like icons and they actually show up and zoom across the page or zoom across the video. And so if people really like what you're saying, then that can go too. And so I'm kind of thinking, yeah, we could play with that. I don't know. I think there's some reward there. I just don't know if it's the kind of reward that I'm really going to be, you know, wanting. But yeah, you know, sponsorship on the videos and stuff too would be nice. And then I think people would be more prone to watch the videos if they have actual people on them instead of just album art.
Right. Yeah. If you had, so like, how many podcast episodes do you release a week? Like overall, you've got
between all the shows.
Yeah.
10.
So, I mean, if you were doing, I would probably suggest putting all of these on one channel, like a devchat.tv channel.
Well, that's what I have right now.
Yeah, yeah. Separate playlist for each podcast, but on the same channel.
Yep. Yeah, and then that way, I mean, good grief, if you put the transcripts up there, you're going to have so much like search engine juice on those. It's going to be crazy.
Right. That's interesting.
Even if you could start with, as an experiment, just start by having somebody go back and like post your, you know, post 50 episodes.
No, I've already done that.
Oh, okay. All right. What kind of search traffic do you get?
Well, I don't know. How do I tell?
You have to go into the analytics. You have to go into like the video editor part of how many. So you have like maybe 50 videos up there now and they're just album art. Probably,
they're just album art.
With the transcripts or with
just the video.
Okay, the full text transcript.
The show notes might be up.
Is important, I think. Well, I'm not sure if you can put the full text transcript actually, but
You can put it in annotations or captions, and that gets searchable.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's interesting.
I put the show notes that they can condense. There's if you go into video editing, there's a specific place for
captions. For annotations. Yeah.
But if you could put the show notes, the condensed list of show notes into the episode description, mm-hmm. and then put the transcript into the captions, and all of that gets searchable. So that'd be pretty phenomenal.
Yeah. I know that we put them in as annotations. And then, the show notes go in as annotations. Mm-hmm. And then, and I think I have like 200 episodes of Ruby Rogues and 200 episodes of JavaScript Jabber up.
Oh, okay, boy. Nice. The other thing would be to have those appropriately tagged and have titles written for them that are not just Ruby Rogues episode 233.
Yeah, the titles are all. They're all, you know, Ruby Rogues episode 235, blah 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 with so and so. So all the titles are set properly.
If you want to put the word Ruby Rogues episode whatever in the title, put it after the content. It goes last.
Yeah, I would write titles for these that are basically blog post titles.
Yeah.
How to whatever type of titles.
How to do XYZ with library W.
Yeah.
Featuring whoever.
Right.
And then in the description, you know, Ruby Rogues, episode number 35, official title. Mm-hmm. You know, that's like the first line of the description is Ruby Rogues, episode number whatever. Link back to the homepage, and then you get to the description.
Right.
Right.
Did you find the traffic on that check by any chance?
I'm trying to find it right now. I don't want to take up the discussion though.
I'm curious how much.
So unless it comes up real fast,
yeah, Because we've got, I mean, we have right now, we have around 1,200 videos. And we are getting about 550,000 views on the videos per month.
Yeah, let's see. So
it's pretty insane.
Where does it tell you how many videos you have? We're getting 1,337 views over the last 28 days.
Okay.
Gained 16 subscribers. Looks like I have 466 videos.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, you need better titles and descriptions and thumbnails on those.
Mm-hmm.
Just thinking about my gaming channel. I mean, I've only got 33 subscribers and I'm not getting more than, you know, 30 or 40 views a day, but I've only been doing it for like a month and I only have like 40 videos up there. But I can look at the analytics and I can see I'm technically growing rapidly.
Uh-huh.
Because I've got good titles, good thumbnails, good descriptions that hit all of the keywords that I want in the description, and then good tags that touch every tag, every possible thing that is shown in the video. And through a combination of all of that, along with having a standard, you know, footer links inside of the description, I have the best of Code Ninja Gaming footer links mm-hmm. in all my videos. So I get a tremendous amount of click through from suggested videos on other people's right. stuff, as well as search terms. Mm-hmm. Those two things are 66% of the traffic that I get. Yeah. You could very rapidly grow your channel if you just start improving, you know, from here forward, improve the title, improve the description, improve the tags, put a good thumbnail on there that shows, you know, something going on in the podcast, and you'll start growing rapidly. I think my Derek Bailey YouTube channel, let me switch over to it real quick. I haven't uploaded a video to my Derek Bailey YouTube channel in forever. I've got 1,446 subscribers, 139,000 total views, but I've continued to grow. This YouTube channel has continued to grow without me doing anything, just because I've got mm-hmm. good titles and good descriptions in there. I mean, I'm looking yeah. at videos that I uploaded, you know, months ago that have thousands of views, 5,000, 3,000, 2,000. I don't talk about them. I don't advertise them. I don't do anything with these except just throw them on YouTube and people find them.
Yeah, that makes sense. I've also got the conference videos that I need to start putting on YouTube.
Oh, good grief. Yes.
Oh, yes.
And I'll create playlists for those. But yeah, and then just have somebody. I'm kind of tempted to have Gerald just go through them and just say, look, if there's a word on the slide that's not to and the, then what, you know, whatever. You know, just put it in as a tag.
So, yeah. So I would put this onto your list of things that could be, you know, something yeah. that could potentially triple, quadruple what you're doing now. I'm not sure yeah. this is it, but this is a good candidate because you've got all this content.
Yeah. Your content is 100 times more valuable than most of what I put on my YouTube channel. And my YouTube channel is far outpacing yours in views and yeah. growth. Mm-hmm. There's no reason it should be this way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I need to just sit down because this is a project for me right now. And I don't have time for another project right now.
Right.
But right. one of my goals for, you know, by the end of April was to increase podcast listenership by 10%.
Well, the project here is to define the process and hire someone to execute it.
Yes, that's true.
So that's not as big absolutely. Of a project as what it sounds like. I mean,
yeah.
if you get somebody like, so you've already got the podcast workflow, right? So, mm-hmm. I mean, we just added this video podcast and it's just an extra couple steps for Rodrigo at this point.
Right.
So, you know, you have an extra module that goes into your publish a podcast
yes.
process, and that is all the steps that are around YouTube.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So it's not really as big as it might seem.
Right. So the question I have as far as tagging goes, because I think that's important. Mm-hmm. I wonder a little bit about having somebody who's not technical or not.
Rodrigo does ours. He does fine.
Okay.
I think you're going to find that the tagging won't be as much to it as you think.
Yeah. Okay.
There's research tools that you can use.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I think if you found somebody who is reasonably capable at doing YouTube videos,
I think they'd
be able to do it for you.
If you can find somebody that knows how to Google a person's name, find their Twitter or their homepage, they'll get 50 keywords to put into tags just.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, that's true.
Search.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see somebody tagged with Donald Trump off of JavaScript Jabber or something. Because they're tweeting about politics. Exactly. Anyway, no, that makes a ton of sense.
Yeah.
And yeah, anybody with two brain cells and can figure out at least some of the keywords that they should be pulling out of Twitter.
Right. The important thing is to hire somebody that knows how to manage a YouTube channel,
mm-hmm.
that has experience doing all these things.
Right.
And this is one we got like swamped with people when we posted on Upwork. So if you want to do this, produce a YouTube ready product here. So take this audio file, come up with something to do with it visually. Tell me what all the tags should be. Kind of give me a finished product other than don't upload it to YouTube.
Right.
And get 10 people to do it, and then that's what we did. And we like Rodrigo, there were like two people that really stood out, and one of them was US based and he was charging like $30 an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And then Rodrigo, we actually kind of liked him better anyway. So,
yeah. But the thing is I can give somebody the show notes, because the show notes are done before the thing publishes.
Right.
And the title is done before the thing publishes, and the recording's done before the thing publishes.
I think they should write a different title for YouTube.
That's fine.
They should be doing keyword research for you and doing a different title, but yeah.
Right. But yeah, then, I like that. How much should I be paying somebody to do a video?
I mean, you can get somebody for 10 or 15 bucks an hour, I think. If you know, you're going to have to, it'll probably be overseas, but you should be.
But how many hours am I going to be paying them to
do a one-hour episode? So one of the things John did was he didn't give any specifications as far as he did one or two of these himself.
Mm-hmm.
So he knew how much time it would take. And then he basically said, go do it, track your time. Just let me know how long it took.
Oh yeah.
And then that way we could get a good idea of what they would actually charge us. Actually, he might've hired them hourly. I think that's what he did. He said like, charge me whatever your hourly rate is. I'll pay it.
Yeah.
You know, and then some people would, we'd paid maybe 75 bucks to edit one stupid video. Well, that's 75 bucks to know that and not know that 3 months from now.
Right.
Right.
So
that makes sense.
Yeah. So I'm not sure, but yeah, like, I mean, looking at all the content that you're generating and coming up with all the different ways that you can leverage it.
Well, I can give them everything from the show. So I can give them the edited audio. I can give them the, the title that went on the webpage. I can give them the show notes. I can give them the transcript. Right. I can give them the album art. I can give them, I can give them all this stuff and then just see what I wind up with.
Yep. Here's another one I'll throw out. So just in terms of, this is, along the theme of leveraging the content, what if you took, this is something else we're considering. What if you took three or four podcasts that were all related around a similar topic and took the transcripts, threw them to a writer who charges 10 bucks an hour and had them create a Kindle book for you? And
That could be interesting.
You have now 50 Kindle books that are all related to developer topics and you're only charging $2 each for them or something, but you've got bounce back offers in there and you're promoting the podcasts and et cetera, et cetera.
Right. That could be interesting too.
There's like a ton of things you can do to repackage what you've got.
Mm-hmm.
And before you go and, you know, spend a lot of time making new products, doing more with what you have already would be a really smart thing to do, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, the other thing is that a lot of these projects for pulling this stuff together, it feels like I could, you know, it would probably take me a week or two for each one to pull the trigger on. And so, you know, in 3, 4, 5 weeks, you know, I've got a lot of this stuff just clicking right along. Mm-hmm. And so,
right. Yep.
Yeah. And if I can make a plan to do this, then the other thing is then I can talk to, then I can actually have an expert come in and help me figure out, okay, how do I convert the people I'm bringing in?
Yep.
To buying customers for the conferences.
Yeah. Right. 'Cause I think your biggest leverage point right now is like, you can make a lot more money selling a $10,000 a quarter sponsorship.
Oh yeah.
Than you can selling a $29 ebook or even a $79 ebook. So,
yeah,
you know, doing whatever you can to grow that, just that piles up a lot faster, right?
Yeah.
I mean, if you could increase your listenership by 25%, you probably
add a 25% raise on sponsorships right there.
You probably get $100K a year extra at least out of that. So it's a lot less work than, you know, launching a new product. Not that you shouldn't do that, but
yeah, but the thing is, and it opens up a whole lot more doors for me
on the
product side of things.
So. You've got some really good systems in place now. And so bolting things into those, like products and selling stuff to your audience, that's like, those are new systems you have to build.
Yes.
And you've got a lot of, there's still a lot of juice left in the systems you've already built that you haven't squeezed out. And so.
Yeah, that makes sense. Cool. Well, sorry I took up all the time.
It's all good, man.
Derek, do you have to run now?
soonish, but I got things I want to talk about. So first off, remember a couple of weeks ago, I basically came to the conclusion that I need to work toward not being reliant on my clients for paying the bills, for my income, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's driving me very rapidly toward experiments with smaller products and doing individual launches each month and things like we've been talking about. So I'm putting together this debugging Docker images webinar. And I've been writing the sales page from things that I'm learning in the copy hour class, which I think the sales page is pretty rock, and I've actually been updating it this morning. I added testimonials. I added a VSL in there.
Oh, nice.
I added some additional
VSL,
video sales letter.
Okay.
I added some repetition of the benefits in, as well as what the content will be, repeating the promise again. I updated the title slightly from what you saw earlier, Josh.
Okay.
I just put the word developers in front of it.
Ah, okay.
And it's got like 10 times more impact now with just nice. That one word in front of it.
Yep.
Developers, yep. How many times do you rebuild your Docker image before you get it right?
Yep. So calling out your audience, it's hard to go wrong with that.
Yeah. And so I was hand copying David Ogilvie's How to Write an Advertisement That Sells this morning. And that was one of his tips in there. I was like,
and you got through part of the first column.
That is probably so perfect. Right? Well, I skipped one. I wrote the general column. Skipped the TV column and I wrote the print column.
That was probably at least a 20,000 word chunk. This ad, it was
1,909.
It was a full page. It was a full page ad. Like in a newspaper, right?
Yeah.
And like really tiny type, like eight point type. So it's basically like, it was like an ebook, you know, or like a lead magnet.
Yeah.
Really.
Wait, I have a question.
Yeah.
When's the next copy hour course?
Yeah.
I think he launches it every quarter.
Yeah. Every quarter. I'm pretty sure. But so I'm doing that and I have this giant fire sitting underneath of me right now. I am in the hot seat for this. because my client, my one giant client, has all but refused to approve any work for me. So I have no client work right now. So, you know, I haven't quit. I haven't given them any ultimatums. I've requested time and time again that they approve some work for me to do. And they swear up and down that they're going to approve some. But I've told them at this point, look, I can't wait for you any longer. I have to move on to other projects for a while because I have bills to pay. So when you get the projects approved, let me know and we will figure out when I can come back and do this work for you. So that,
keep
that's
using putting words that rhyme. Yeah. Giant, client, reliant.
I'm a poet and I didn't know it. So that's putting a giant fire under my butt to really make some of this stuff work, which is why one of the reasons why getting the sales page done right is important to me, because I need to be able to reproduce results every month and I need the practice on doing this. Mm-hmm. I mean, Josh, you mentioned in our email that you slapped together a sales page and it worked, but that's like Perry Marshall telling you he can 10x your business in his sleep.
Well, that is, there's some truth to that. Yeah. Well, but see, okay. But also just, I'm trying to accomplish with that is just to de-stress you a little bit, because
that ain't going to happen.
Until
the money is rolling in, yeah, that ain't going to happen.
Well, and then
show me the money.
Keep in mind the 40-40-20, right?
Yeah,
the offer and the list and then the copy. So it's I don't think you're going to let you do this, but don't tweak this for the rest of your life.
And no, certainly not. I need to be done with this. I think I am pretty much done with this. I might do like an FAQ at the bottom of it, just, you know, real simple things that aren't going to take more than a couple of minutes to write. But I need to get on the emails for this now, which I know I need to treat this like any other launch, but my typical launch has build up, you know, stories and information.
Right.
And I only have a couple of weeks to sell this thing before the webinar is actually going live. So how much of a launch do I really do versus just promoting it?
Real quick on the just one other thing on the sales page. A rule of thumb that I go by with formatting is that I don't like to interrupt the flow of the text with graphics for the most part. So you had in a couple places where you've got, because that encourages skimming.
Right.
So I would take your stick figure and shove him off to the right.
Really?
So you get an unbroken line. It's good to have good to have subheaders.
Gotcha.
But you want that unbroken line of readable text so that they're not having a speed bump that they have to jump over visually.
Gotcha. Makes sense. That's an easy fix.
That's an easy fix. So as far as like how much of a launch,
So my typical launch is usually it's at least a week. Built a week of build up, 3 to 5 emails doing the build up, and then a week of constant reminders. So what would your recommendation be in this case? I mean, how much build up? I have the sales page in a state where I could literally tweet this and people could start paying me money.
Right.
But how much of a build up do I put into this versus promoting it, you know, sending out emails that tell stories or talk about problems or whatever, but are primarily there to promote it instead of build the anticipation for it?
Right. And I think you can do that.
Okay.
I don't think you need a bunch of build up ahead of time.
Right. I think I've had a lot of build up around Docker in the last 6 months already.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is not a topic switch for your list. Yeah.
Right.
So I would just do, I would probably do the way I did mine was I did a 2-week promotional window.
Okay.
Which is actually pretty long. I did zero build up. I just announced it one day.
Right.
And then I just started promoting it every day. I'd do my usual emails and then I'd promote it. And then a bunch of the sales came in at the end.
Right.
As usual. So I would sell like a couple every day, and then I got a flood of them on the last day.
Okay.
This is a small ticket. This is like an impulse buy type of thing. So
it totally is.
Yeah, you don't. Yep. You don't need a lot of big hoopla
right
beforehand.
Okay. I need you, Josh, to email an example of how you do the segmentation inside of your email for drip.
Oh, yeah, I can.
The liquid tags to do that, because yeah, I know who needs to see what copy in terms of pricing in the emails. I just don't know how to put the liquid templates together to show them correctly.
Okay. Yeah, I'll send you. I was actually just screwing around with that today, so I can send you. Liquid's a little bit weak when it comes to like if else.
Yeah.
So yeah, I came up with a way that kind of worked. That was like, let me do several levels of fallback. Right. I don't remember the details of it, but I'll shoot you that when we get off here.
Okay.
But yeah, so one thing I've learned too is I've tried both ways, where the first email, sometimes I'll try it more of a content email and kind of mm-hmm. like that backs into pitching the product at the end. And then I've found that actually I get the best success if I'm just like straight out of the gate, bam, right, like here's the offer, be real straightforward about it.
Right.
And then don't be coy. And then content reminder.
Right.
And then, you know, hit the scarcity at the end really hard when the cart's closing.
Okay.
And with this one, you know, it's live, so you've got a lot of leverage. And,
yeah,
you know, and you can say, okay, I would definitely say like, I will sell this later and it will cost you more.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's going to be $50 if you buy it later.
Yeah. I was thinking $29 later, but I'm going to include the transcript, and any additional resources I can pull from.
Make it $50. Dude, what I did was like, I might've started at $29, but then I like kept adding to it.
Okay.
So I've got like that there. I'm actually going to probably raise the price on that product to $99 because there's like a ton of stuff. I have like a whole 1 hour video where I'd go through the Plinko machine in drip. I've got like copy that I wrote for John. I've got a bunch of different bonuses, interview I did with Chuck.
Yeah.
So yeah, like lots mm-hmm. of stuff. And I think it's worth $99.
Cool. Okay. Well, that gives me some things to talk about then, and to put in the FAQ at the bottom of the page as well. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that's kind of been my week, is panicking about my client and the lack of work that I have with them right now. Mm-hmm. Kicking myself in the butt to get this page done, get the marketing rolling. I've had a little bit of feedback from a few developers, a couple of which have almost said, shut up and take my money. And one of which said, I sincerely hope this succeeds, but I don't think you're going to sell any seats.
So, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, that was a bit of a downer, but you know,
whatever. Shut up and take my money. So all he said is, I'm not in your audience, really.
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, and he disqualified himself from my audience with his opening statement of, I don't understand why somebody would pay this much to learn how to use such a simple tool.
Yep.
And of course it's simple because he knows the answers already.
Right.
Yep.
So yeah. He disqualified himself pretty immediately, but I've got enough evidence from my Docker cheat sheets and my Docker videos mm-hmm. and other stuff, and the social proof that I put on there.
Mm-hmm.
So I hope it does well. I hope my copywriting skills have improved enough that it makes a dramatic improvement in.
Derek, I actually wrote an email. I wrote an email after our conversation.
Yeah.
But I've been super impressed with the progress that you've made. Like the way that you're thinking about problems now is really cool. It's really been really cool to watch. Like I've seen a bunch of light switches come on, and you're still kind of thrashed a little bit. And I do too. Yeah. But you have a logical sequence that you work through now when you're tackling these type of problems. And
right.
you're getting good, you know, you're getting to a good place with it. So,
well, it's been pretty phenomenal going through this course, because it's reinstilled a lot of the things that you tried to teach me all those times that we
immersion
tried to work together. Yeah, it totally is. It's it's bringing up these points again and again in new and different ways, and showing it to me through advertisements that I am copying by hand, which you know, there's so much benefit to doing that. Yeah. I'm at the point now where I'm doing research for Docker, and I'm trying to restart some research for RabbitMQ to remarket that, and I'm looking into the whole works on my machine problem, and I'm handwriting all of my research because I'm finding it to be so beneficial in my thought process.
Nice.
Well, this is something that I used to do years ago as a developer before you know, the explosion of you know, note-taking software and mind-mapping software and stuff. Every time I went to a meeting with anyone, I would bring a piece of paper with me, and I would handwrite all my notes. And I'm kind of getting back to my roots.
This, like, copywriting in general and this course in particular is so, like, it's one of the few things I think every entrepreneur should learn, even if you don't intend to do your own copywriting, because it freaking trains you to think like an entrepreneur, right? That's where so many people fall down, is you're not thinking about, like, how am I going to, if you can see in your head how you're going to market this 10 steps down the line, that changes the way you think about products and everything. Like it.
Finding that one big thing, that one emotion, that one selling point is kind of huge for me, because I see a lot of the failure of my RabbitMQ marketing as grasping at straws, not understanding what that one thing is. Well, RabbitMQ lets you do this, and it lets you do that, and it solves this, and it okay, you're giving me the shotgun effect here, and I may have latched on to one of these, but I don't really care about the rest of them, and I'm confused now.
Right. Yeah, that's actually where Adrian, who we've talked about on the show, I think he's been on the show.
Yeah.
With this Python course is so interesting, because he's taking what he's been able to do is take people who want a specific they want to be able to do image recognition for their product, because they have a product idea, and then he's convincing them to learn Python.
Yeah.
he's starting with the problem is like, I want to do this image recognition. And they don't care about the solution. And the solution happens to be
use Python.
He teaches them Python. It could be he writes the Python for them too. But
yeah, if I can find that level of problem, the business need, the feature that you need in your software, the thing that I can show you how to solve, and it happens to be solved with RabbitMQ.
Right.
You know, that's going to be huge again. And I think the whole works on my machine angle with Docker is a huge angle.
I feel like that's really, really powerful just because of the agony and pain I went through with. So here, I mean, I don't know if this would be useful, but stories like this would be what you want to tell this week when you launch this. So
you fill out my survey.
so just real quick version of it is I was doing iPhone testing when I was a trackabout, and I had my iPhone set to Eastern, like US time zone, and the QA person had theirs set to India, because she was from India.
Right.
And freaking could not reproduce this bug. I mean, we went back and forth like two days. And then finally figured out that was what the, as soon as I changed the time zone in my iOS simulator, I could, so like that works on my machine, that wastes so much time.
Yeah. So true.
And it is the most frustrating thing, because you want to fix the problem. You think you fix it, you know, and meanwhile you're risking introducing new bugs, by the way.
Right.
Every time you touch it, and you know, and QA just keeps swatting it back at you, and everybody's looking at you like, what is your problem? Get this out the door. It's horrible. So,
yeah. Well, the other part of the copywriting that I've been seeing from you, Derek, is not just the identifying the major issue, you know, knowing which button to push or which thread to pull on, but just knowing, you know, how much to pull, you know, you pull it out about that far.
Yeah.
And then if I give it a little tug, then it's like, yeah, that hurts. And so then they go by, and then, you know, and then you pull a little bit more for a few more people, and then you give it that extra little tug again, and, you know, and it's like, oh yeah, yeah, that sucks. And yeah, you know, you've gotten really good at that too. Just, you know, how far to frame that message, how far to pull that thread out before you prompt them to cut it.
Right. I'm getting there. I'm hoping this works. This is a grand experiment with my income on the line. I mean, I'm certainly not going to starve. I won't lose my house, you know, things like that. We have a little bit of money, but I have a massive amount of credit card debt that needs to be paid off. So I really need this to work.
Yep.
So, all right. I do need to get going, guys. I now have a regular 12:30 lunch on Friday at a local barbecue place that just opened. And it is literally hands down the best barbecue I have ever had.
Nice.
So me and my Wednesday co-working group, we all go to barbecue on Fridays now.
Nice.
Cool.
All right, guys, I got to get going. But yeah, well, I'll see you guys next week at the same time.
Okay.
Yep.
See ya.
Bye.
All right. We should wrap things up here.
I was going to say we're well over our time anyway. Yeah.
We started a few minutes late, so.
We did.
We're only about 5 minutes over.
Yeah. I've been thinking a lot, though, about that, just doubling down on the podcast, because if I can grow the existing audience, I'm already starting to fill those second episodes, and I'm getting a ton of feedback. Yeah, this just, it seems obvious now.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, and even, you know, like for us, our sponsorship for the podcast is a lot smaller, but we increased ours. We just went to publishing daily episodes.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So.
Yep. All right. Well, thoughts, I guess.
This isn't real deep, but so I did an email this week for the simple. Well, so one thing I've realized over the last few weeks, I did some digging into our, like into Drip and looking at our customer lifetime value and everything. And we have, how did this go? So if we have the top 20% most active part of our list is about 1 in 4 of them are customers. The bottom 80% of our list, only 1 in 20 are customers. So like just based on email opens and everything. I'm not doing anything special for those top 20%. And so I'm starting to do more content emails and stuff for the email list. So I sent out an email yesterday, and it was pure content. It was basically about the whole coding puzzle thing and how John's the way that John approaches those types of algorithms and coding puzzles. And we got a reply from somebody, and he was like, I've been trying to unsubscribe from all of these marketing emails. And I'm like, it's not a marketing email, you moron. It was straight 100% content, free content, links to more free content on John's YouTube channel about the same topic. There was no product link, there was no pitch, nothing. It was pure content, pure value, and the guy is still complaining. So I wrote my email this morning. I was like, look, people, no matter what you do on your email list, you are going to tick somebody off and they're going to complain about it. And so don't be, you know, don't worry about it. Don't take it personally when people complain when you pitch, because they complain when you send them free content too. So yep. that's my thought.
Heck, I've had people complain that, you know, when I send them just the show notes from the episode.
It's ridiculous. You signed up for. So, yeah, this guy wanted us to take him off all of the broadcasts except for the weekly Here's What You Missed on Simple Programmer. And I'm like, look, there's an implicit contract. When you sign up for an email list, you are saying, you're going to freely give me your expertise and your wisdom. And in return, I will accept some level of marketing and hearing about your products and services. That is like I don't allow people to opt out of the subscribers to opt out of their side of that. You don't get the free goodies without occasionally hearing a pitch from me. Sorry.
Well, the other thing is, and I don't think people understand this unless they actually set up a newsletter, but I think MailChimp gives you 2,000 people on your list for free, and you can only email them a certain amount. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I have a list that has 11,400 people or something on it now. And so I have to pay for it. which costs a little more, but I got to pay for you to be on the list. And so if I got to pay for you to be on the list, then you got to help me pay for you to be on the list.
Yeah. I mean, our drip bill is over $700 a month now.
I haven't even looked. So, I'm pretty sure mine's over $200 a month.
Yeah.
But I haven't looked. I really don't know that. So I probably shouldn't say it. But anyway, it's worth it because it's a terrific tool and it does what I need it to do. Incidentally, I am abandoning ActiveCampaign. Okay. But overall, it's just, if I have to pay to send you good content, then you're going to have to sit through a couple of sales pitches because somebody's going to buy. Somebody's going to pay for your spot on my list.
Yep.
So.
Amen.
Yeah. And the other thing is it's not like I'm, okay, well, here's a bucket of manure.
Right. Right. My rule is like, I don't waste people's time. I don't waste my subscribers' time. So if there's something I'm sending out, it is valuable enough for them to at least give it some consideration.
Right. And that's the other thing too, for me is like, you know, I don't take sponsors unless I have a chance to check them out. I don't email you a pitch unless it's something that I've worked hard on that I think you're going to benefit from. So anyway,
here.
Yep. Anyway, so I'm with you on that. My thoughts are mostly along the lines of just just biting off more than you can chew. You know, I mentioned that, you know, I was like, oh, I've got people to do this stuff, and so then I increased my task list basically. And, you know,
yes,
I overbalanced the scale again. But the flip side of that is that I found that in a lot of ways that's how things grow.
Mm-hmm.
Is okay. I have more capacity, so now I'm going to take on more stuff.
Right.
And, you know, here's the next stage of things that I think are going to pay off.
Right.
And then you weed some of that out, and then you realize, you know what, some of the stuff that I kind of picked up along the way is stuff that I need to keep doing.
Yep.
And so then you pull somebody else in, and you get them to do that stuff. And yeah, so mm-hmm. that's kind of the way that things move. But at the same time, you kind of have to take that risk to hire that person or take that risk to do that thing, even though it may not pay off initially. Otherwise you're just not going to grow, or you're not going to grow fast, very fast. So, just the whole risk reward, setup for entrepreneurs. And I hear a lot of people yelling and screaming about how, you know, every American should, you know, deserves a job or this or that, or they're talking about, you know, some base level income that everybody gets. And, I have a hard time, you know, some people, they're just going to need help, period. Right. They have some mental or physical disability and they're going to need help. But, I have a hard time, you know, basically saying, look, if you're not willing to take any of the risks, then, you know, why should you have all of the benefits?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so, you know, entrepreneurship is hard. And, you know, the reason that people are where they are in a lot of cases is because they saw some need, they saw some opportunity, and they took a risk, and everybody benefited from it. And that's the way that capitalism is set up, and that's the way these things work. And so unless the government or, you know, some other group gets involved to give somebody an unfair advantage that isn't market-driven, you know, it's these people coming out and finding a solution for something. And so, you know, I kind of waxed a little bit political there, but mostly it's just if you want something, if you have a particular reward in mind, if you're looking for some payoff, then you're probably going to have to take some kind of risk to get it. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, if you have to stretch a little higher, jump a little further, whatever, you know, just be aware that, that's the way these things work. And that's the way that it always has worked. And, you know, so if you're looking at your business and you're saying, I have no idea, you know, this is where I want to go to and I have no idea how to get there. You know, do a little research and then just take a big flying leap and go for it.
Amen. And deliver fast, right?
Deliver fast. Oh, yeah. So I'm wearing my shirt from Cashfly. Nice. I should have worn my Trust the Process shirt.
Oh, nice.
But yeah, Cashfly is the host for all the media for devchat.tv.
Ah, okay.
And they have a sponsorship deal with me for an undisclosed amount. They provide the bandwidth for the audio.
Oh, so. Okay. Nice. All right, Chuck.
Well, next week I am taking my son to the Leonardo, which is a big museum up in Salt Lake.
Oh, that's
an interactive museum. He goes to the online charter school and they're doing a field trip, which means I get to go. So I won't be here next week, but I will be here the week after.
Okay. So. All righty. We'll see you in 2 weeks then.
Oh, wait. Nope. I won't be here the next week either. Well, I might be. We'll see.
I'm starting to question your commitment.
I know, right? My wife and I take a trip every year down to St. George. We go look at the model homes down there. And that's that next week. And we're leaving on Friday. So.
All right. Well, then, 3 weeks from now.
Yep.
See ya.
And I'm looking forward to MicroConf. Yeah, we'll see ya.
All right.
Bye. Want to start a business, but you just know how to code. Listen to John, Josh, and Derek as we figure it out. We are the Entreprogrammers, and we'll teach you straight up.